epic, awesome show, anime podcast number 173. I'm Zain, and we actually have some really cool, awesome guests here. Would you guys like to introduce yourselves?
Yeah. Okay, definitely. You want to go first?
Yeah, so my name is Zain as well from TeamLift's Otaku Lounge podcast.
Ooh.
Yeah, and I am Roderick, a.k.a. Coach. I also do the Otaku Lounge podcast as well as the TeamLift podcast.
Ooh, sounds like a lot of fun. So let's get this started off here. Let's talk a little bit about the anime that we watched this week. And one of the animes that I know I had talked to you beforehand, it was actually not even this, I think it was like last, it was technically this week, because, you know, when we actually go, we go Saturday to Saturday. James told me about this one series. And I think you know the series I'm going to talk about here. Because it's the weirdest series, and, if I can actually remember what it is. Okay, it is a Netsuo Trap.
Oh,
N-T-R.
Yeah.
And I watched the first episode because he was like, oh, I know, you gotta watch the first episode. And I'm like, okay, I'll watch the first episode. And many regrets were had there.
You didn't enjoy it.
It was weird. It was just like, okay, these are not, you know, these are I would say high schoolers.
Yeah, they're just school.
It's borderline hentai. This is borderline porn.
I'm not going to deny that.
it makes me the weird thing is, though, it makes me really uncomfortable. Like, it's really weird. I think that's the weird thing about it, is the reason why I don't really like it as much, because it's this very weird thing, and it comes out of absolute nowhere, where it's just like, all of a sudden, it's just like, okay, she's starting to feel her up, and then they're going to the bathroom, and then, oh boy, this is becoming interesting. This is becoming to the point of just like, I don't know if I want to continue watching this, especially because I know further on the line, one of the chick's boyfriends wants to get in on the action, and then it just makes it even, oh my goodness.
Yeah, I'm on episode 6. Okay. Of the 12 episode run. I'm caught up. I'm on episode 6.
I'm starting it this week because cringe is like my lifeblood. Like cringe and slice of life. That's me.
Yeah, we have a episode coming up that we're doing for Otaku Lounge, which is the cringe episode where we're going to pick the most cringe worthy. This is making a run for the list.
Yeah, yeah.
It is.
Yeah, this is like, it's one of those series where it definitely isn't up there this year. I mean, this season alone has actually had a pretty good amount of animes that are really good. For instance, Gamers is amazing. I don't know if you've watched that or not, but the dub of that?
Oh, yeah.
I highly recommend the dub of it because it's on point. It's the voice actors that they got for the simuldub for it is just perfect because they hit their cues. Their inflections are just right where it works perfectly.
Yeah, and now that's what I have been watching in subs. So I need I guess the dub is going on Funimation,
yes,
right?
Yes. Okay. Yeah, it is available on Funimation, which you can get. I think it's like a 7-day free trial. I think with Funimation, if you do something like that, it was like kind of something cool that they actually Funimation was doing, and at Aniplex was actually really cool. Not Aniplex, but Anime Expo. Mm-hmm. Anime Expo, they were doing something like saying, oh, you don't have it? Okay. Your first month's going to be 99 cents after your free trial. So literally, all you had to pay was 99 cents and you have it for a month.
Oh, nice.
That was actually something that was really cool. Granted, I didn't do it because I already had it, and I've had it for a long time at this point. And pretty much I'm paid up for a year for Funimation, so I got to keep up with some of the shows there because I love... Oh, man, goodness. Looking at all the dubs that are out there right now, Funimation has to be one of my favorites for a dubbing company.
Right. Yeah, they usually have the best quality as far as dubbing goes. Like, them and Sentai, I think, have some of the best really quality dubs.
I would say Sentai has been, as of late, has been really good. Now, granted, there's been a few things here and there that have, you know, maybe taken things down a little bit for some of the dubs that they do. Like, for instance, Cross-Ange. Yeah, Cross-Ange is one that is a really fun series, but the problem with Cross-Ange is that some of the side characters, I just don't feel like they were as strong as, say, some of the main characters, which, you know, it's important for the main characters to be strong, and they are strong, they're great, they're amazing series, but the dub is not as solid. But granted, you go to My Love Story is absolutely solid all the way through. No Game, No Life is another one that's absolutely solid.
Let's talk about My Love Story. Absolutely love that. Absolutely love that.
This guy loves fucking rom-com and shit.
Man, I'm a rom-com addict, and I bought all the manga of that one. So I'm like, when you talk to me about, you know, My Love Story, I'm like, there was no bad version of that. There was none.
Yeah. My Love Story is a very interesting anime because I didn't think I would like it. And then I went to the thing here in Houston. It was in Katy, Texas. And it was at the basically the anime night that Sentai does. And it was really good. And right now you can actually get it on High Dive right now as well. You can watch the entire dub, not for free, but for I think it's like $5 a month.
Yeah, it is. And that is like, there is some great stuff coming there.
Mm-hmm.
And I think they secured a new series, if I'm correct, in the last few days.
I believe Sentai has. Let me look that up. Like, Sentai has done a lot. There's certain series like, okay, so let's talk a little bit about, we can talk a little bit about Sentai here. What has been one of the series for you guys that you were surprised that they've picked up?
Bringing the hard questions out already.
I already know the answer to this, like what my answer would be.
You know, hit me. What's yours?
Mine are basically, Parasite was one that I was surprised that they got. When it was, No Game, No Life wasn't one that was surprising. Black Bullet's another one that was surprising. Akame ga Kill was another one that was very surprising when they picked that up.
You know,
and Chaika is another one that actually was very surprising that they picked up.
But didn't they do? I guess they technically did Ajin, but that ran on Netflix. But that was one of their series, wasn't it?
Ajin?
Yeah.
I don't believe so. Let me
I think that's one of
their.
Yeah,
Ajin.
How do you spell that?
A-J-I-N.
Damn, we got that in unison.
actually done by. I need to look at the names here because the names I can almost tell you exactly who the dub was done by, because I believe it was done by if I'm not mistaken. I gotta look at the English names here. Yeah, Johnny and Bosch, Todd Habercorn. It was done by Bang Zoom.
Okay.
So they must have just published it because it's in their catalog.
That's in their catalog. Yeah, they have it
into their catalog. They may have actually published it, but the dub itself was done by Bang Zoom, which wouldn't surprise me at all. That actually is in their catalog of their shows there. Cause
this one's going back a little bit, but they fucking, like, Big O was a good one that they did.
I'm happy that they picked that up, though. I'm really happy that, you know, we were able to actually buy it and actually, you know, watch it legit through High Dive as well.
And in season, I think, Batum, or that's not in season, that's recent, though. Batum was the one that they did.
But see, the thing about Batum was that they only did one season of it, and that one season was basically the entire manga run, and then they had to put it on hiatus to let the manga get ahead again, and now it's on hiatus alone. We're never going to be too. Never getting season two. I had people mad at me because I turned them on to that anime.
Yeah. So there's an actual anime that they picked up that they did a dub for, and it's an anime I absolutely despise to the nth degree. And I'm probably going to get some hate for it. But that is, oh my goodness, I'm trying to think of the actual name of it. I actually got to look at it right quick. It's Monster Musume, Everyday with a Life with Monster Girls. And... Okay.
Oh, I'm with you on this one.
I hate this series with a passion, and a lot of it is due to the fact that I guess it might be the fact that the fan service is just too much. Like, there becomes a point in time where it's just like, I don't like enough. Like, fan service, I don't mind it. Like, you look at, you know, you look at my collection, I have Kill la Kill. Like, obviously, fan
that
service
was,
is not a problem for me.
Tasteful fan service. Like, yes. It's part of the story.
Oh,
it's not,
it gets pretty cringy, though. It gets pretty cringy, because I was watching that at my aunt's house, watching Kill la Kill at my aunt's house.
Yeah.
And I got to the part where, it wasn't, what was her name? Akatsuki? I want to say what her name was, Akatsuki. I'm not sure. I gotta actually look the character's name up, because I can't remember her name.
I have a theory. And I always used to ask one of my buddies this, would you watch it with a priest, Jesus, and your mama? And that's pretty much how you... If you can say, I would watch it with all three of them, it's not worth being on the
election. It gets pretty bad, though. It gets pretty bad.
I would watch it with them.
Kill la Kill, I mean, the only reason why I say it gets pretty bad, because of Satsuki and her mom, it gets to the point where it's very lesbian.
Yeah, I remember
that moment in time. It's literally just that one moment where she's literally feeling her up, and it's just like, oh my goodness, this is... And I'm watching it at my aunt's house, and I'm like, please don't come down at Margie. I don't want to have to explain this. I don't want to have to explain this.
I don't want to explain anything I watch, man. But I'm, but then again, I'm also on episode 6 of this crazy, you know, Netflix. I'm watching a lot of stuff that we can't explain, man.
Yeah.
But that... But here's my thing. Like, when I think of Sentai, I think of, like, three series that I watched in sub. So, like, Momo Kuri, Monthly Girl Nozaki-kun.
Oh, my goodness. Monthly Girl Nozaki-kun. That dub is amazing.
Yeah, I mean, these were great series that they did.
Oh, yeah.
I was all, you know, once again, you're probably picking up a theme. That guy watches a lot of rom-com. Yeah, I really
That's pretty much the...
Fucking gamers.
Yeah. That's actually pretty much the Sentai, though. Like, rom-coms, slice of life, I would say fan service type anime is what Sentai usually picks up. So that's the reason why I was kind of surprised with, like...
Too.
What?
I think, didn't they do High School of the Dead or have some portion?
They do have High School of the Dead. And that anime is amazing, though. That anime is like, okay, name another anime that has the Matrix boobies. Anime that has that. Like, the bullet goes perfectly shaped breasts, you know, perfectly through everything. It's like, and it's just like, oh my goodness. Any other situation, this is just so stupid. It's amazing.
Yeah, but man, that show. Now, you talk about some cringe. Some stuff that bus. Can we just say,
what?
Episode 7, 8, some stuff goes down on that bus when they get trapped on the bus.
Oh yeah. I mean, there is cringe, though, factor to it. But I think the one thing I have to say about the cringe factor in that is it feels like a B-rated zombie movie. It just feels like a lower level, you know, a zombie film that is just... It's trying so hard to want you to take it seriously, but then it does stupid things where it's just like... It's just everything works perfectly. Is it good? Debatable. But it's not the most terrible thing in the world.
No, it's definitely not the most terrible.
Yeah, if we're going to go cringe, there's some things that friggin' coach here won't even watch.
Hey, you know what? Speaking of that, is that one of theirs?
What? Oreimo?
Oreimo.
I don't know if they do Oreimo.
Oreimo.
My little sister can't be this cute.
It was terrible. Okay, look, I don't do incest.
Yeah, I don't think it's one of theirs.
No, I think that it's actually, I believe... It is done by Media Blasters, I believe. It looks like a Media Blaster title, but I could be completely wrong on this one.
No, that's about right. It just doesn't seem right. But see, man, like I'm sitting here thinking about...
It's licensed by Aniplex.
Is it?
Oh, that makes sense.
It is actually licensed by Aniplex because it's done by... It looks like that might be the anime, yeah. Hold on, let me double check that. Yeah, it is Aniplex. That's licensed.
There's a fucking change.org petition to make Oreimo English dubbed.
Sorry. There's always going to be, you know, like, how many signatures does it have?
33.
Only 33 signatures?
Yeah.
Wow. I can see there being I would say that's very... for an English dub for that, I think it would be very... moot on that one. Like,
I mean, Alabama would take over, right? Alabama. Would,
like, the entire state of Alabama would love this series. Be like,
we can bring anime to Alabama. Just fucking dub Primo. Let's do it.
Mm-mm.
No.
Guess that one all the way. I will tell you one. I don't know if you guys watch this rom-com, but it's got Fields of Plenty. Get 1 week Friends in your life.
1 week Friends? I've heard of it.
Yes, and I think that is on High Dive. I believe when I watched this, it was when Sentai had its entire library on Hulu. I think that's how I caught it. That was how I watched it.
Okay.
And I think I did the dub of that. I think a lot of times if I can't find a dub, I'll just watch the sub because, you know, it's licensed, you know, you know, Crunchyroll or Hulu or somebody. I think I pulled 1 week Friends from Hulu.
There's a live action movie for that.
There is actually a live action movie of that one coming. So if you guys want to get caught up this year, that's a good one. Rom-com guy. That's all I know. Rom-coms.
I mean, the one series. Okay. Why in the world can I not get into High Dive? I'm having some issues here. Don't mind me. I'm just having some major...
Passwords.
I can't remember my password to get in there. I'll just forget your password. Yes, forgot my password. Because I was going to look at all this stuff here and be like, oh, yeah. Da-da-da-da. You know, I could actually look into it, and then it's just High Dive isn't wanting to work for me today. It's wanting to be an idiot.
I was asking Zain if he did High Dive.
This is going to be a confusing cock if we keep using first names, too.
Zain. Oh, yeah. Because I'm Zain 1, Zain 2. No. De Lopez.
Yeah, you can call me Lopez.
I will call you Lopez and we'll call him Zain. That's how we'll do it. Okay. All right. So, Lopez, did you get a High Dive account?
I have no High Dive account.
Okay.
So it's a subscription-based thing, right, too?
Right.
I think I could probably throw that into my, like, 12 subscriptions.
Yeah, this was $5 a month, but the thing is, it's pretty much the only thing I think that keeps a lot of people from jumping on that train is that it's only computer based. You can't. There are no.
Yeah. That's where I watch all my anime.
Okay, you're good.
I don't go on. I don't sit on the toilet for 30 minutes to watch an episode of anything. So I mean.
Yeah. Well, good. I usually go through my PS4. That's usually what I do.
Don't judge me. I had to sit on the toilet to watch a whole episode.
Okay, this is weird. My thing is set for not. It's set for Canada. Why am I in Canada?
Why are you in Canada? What the hell?
I don't know why I'm in Canada. Like my little flag here. Is showing me up in Canada, and it's like, what?
You're doing some interesting stuff in your life. That's what I like about this show.
Like, I don't know why.
Passwords, living in Canada. You're doing everything.
I didn't know that they're Houston in Canada.
Yeah, I didn't know that.
Like, apparently it does, because it's like showing up as a little Canadian flag there. So it's like, okay, apparently I'm Canadian, eh?
There you go.
But no, some of the best things I think High Dive is doing right now, High Dive, not High Dove. Yeah, you know. Those things that flutter in the sky. The dubs that they do is amazing, and I love what Sentai is doing with that, with the dubs there, is that they're releasing the dubs before the DVD comes out.
Oh.
And on High Dive, yeah. And it's usually I believe it's the entire dub that's available, that they actually put available on there, so you can actually watch it all. And then, you know, oh, you like it, you can buy it. It's for pre-order now.
And I know that they pulled a lot of their stuff off of other for other channels, and so it's only going to be, you know, like, hey, come to High Dive to get all this.
Yeah.
Now, what kills me is a lot of the stuff that they pulled there was stuff that they had on Hulu. Like, Hulu had a really fat, like, library, but Sentai Filmworks propped that whole thing up.
Yeah. Well, I mean, the thing is, though, is that really, their dub selection right now is probably one of the best dub selections I've seen them. You know, it's better than the dub selection that they had before with the Anime Network.
Mm-hmm.
I thought with the Anime Network, it was terrible. Their selection was utter garbage. They had very little simulcasts on there. Their series just weren't that many. Were very few and far between. A lot of subs and not enough dubs to really say, oh, it's worth the money. Now it's only, I think it's like $4 a month. And you have, you know, over 20 different series.
I think Anime Network has a special place in my family, though, because it's the reason that my sisters got into anime.
Yeah.
I think I got them watching some show about, like, trapeze people, like, dance, like, women performing and crazy, like, stunts and shit, and that's what got them going.
No, I mean, it's like, yeah, I totally understand that. I mean, I totally understand people get started in different ways. I mean, let's talk a little bit about, you know, how exactly, what anime got you into anime?
I think mine is a combination, because, I mean, I'm 24, I'm a freaking millennial. I think it's basically a cross between two, because I collected Pokemon cards as a kid, and I had, like, the entire first season on VHS.
When you actually, well, let's go with not your first anime ever, but let's go with the one that you really knew it was anime, and you just fell in love with it, and you started wanting to collect and all that stuff.
Let's see. So the first thing that got me into anime then, if we're not counting Pokemon, would be probably Inuyasha, actually.
Interesting.
And from there, like, shonens went, I was crazy for shonens growing up, and then lately, what started me?
We just talked about this.
Like, a year ago, I started my Crunchyroll subscription, and I forget what the hell show it was to watch, but, like, that, I'll pull it up here in a second, I can fucking talk on that for a minute, but, yeah, like, I started a Crunchyroll subscription for one specific show, and then it just kind of took off, like, a year ago. Like, I've always liked anime, but I've been like, I'm gonna go all in, like, the last year has been crazy.
So what about you, man?
I'm so freaking old. Like, I just stop and I think, bro, I'm really old. Because, like, I think the first, like, I remember when I was a kid, now this is really gonna tell you how old I am, Speed Racer and Battle of the Planets were actually on TV.
Yeah.
Like, they were still airing after school. But if I talk about the first anime where it locked me in and I knew, this is it, I'm done, this is the far superior animation and storylines, I'm going to have to say Robotech, the Macross Saga.
Okay.
It was the one that locked me in. And when it came to Netflix, like, 4 months ago, and they put, like, the entire Robotech run on there, I seriously, part of my vacation was spent watching that.
Nice.
Yeah, so I just kind of was like, I'm going back through this whole series.
Yeah.
I watched all the good to the crap. I watched it.
Actually, for me personally, probably the anime that got me really hooked on anime, to the point where I just wanted to keep watching it, and keep watching it all the way to the end, was Fullmetal Alchemist. Was one of the first ones I started watching. Granted, both me and my sister were big fans of anime pretty much through the entire thing. Like, I was always a big fan of anime. My sister's always been a big fan of anime. So it's like we both were big into it. Not really, like, I got bigger into anime than she did, which, you know, is like, I just love anime to death right now. But the thing is that Fullmetal Alchemist was one of the first ones that, for two reasons there, is that the story was amazing. I loved the story. But then Funimation was also the first, not Funimation, but Fullmetal Alchemist Brotherhood was also the first one that I actually sat down and watched the entire sub. It was the one I started from the sub from the beginning all the way to the end.
Hmm.
So it was one of the first ones for me that was just like, the Fullmetal Alchemist series is just amazing. If anybody has not seen the Fullmetal Alchemist series, you don't know what you're missing.
I remember my anime.
What?
So I just remembered the anime that got started on anime again. Gurren Lagann, actually. And it wasn't Crunchyroll, it was Netflix. I was like scrolling through Netflix and I was like, Gurren Lagann. I was like, oh, that sounds cool. It's like all mechs and shit. So I started watching that, and like, there's Phil, there's awesome fucking action, there's a cool story, and the ending fucking killed me. And then after that, I was like, man, I need more Phils in my life.
You know, I never watched it.
You never watched it?
I never watched
it.
Gurren Lagann is, well, basically, Gurren Lagann is one of those animes that is perfect in every single way, every aspect of it. Are you guys a big fan of Trigger, Studio Trigger?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
They were actually the people that were behind pretty much most of what Studio Trigger does, like Kill la Kill and all that stuff, were behind Gurren Lagann. Granted, they weren't considered, they weren't Trigger at the time, but people from that studio, I think it was Gainax, moved over and created Studio Trigger. And you see a lot of that art style, the insane art style that is Studio Trigger, and that is Oh my goodness, I could talk about Trigger forever.
Which, that's its own show. That seriously is its own topic, man.
Oh yeah, I mean, Studio Trigger is amazing, and they're just amazing at what they do. Everything that Studio Trigger is, I absolutely adore them for it.
Yeah, see, man, now I don't want to get off. We're not going to derail. I will agree with you on that
well,
one.
Well, I mean, technically, we've been not really on a rail, so it's all good.
True.
But, okay, so talking about some anime here, I think we've gone over the anime that we all got us into anime here. Let's go into a little bit the dumbest anime series, the best and dumbest anime series. I think for all of us, I don't know if we've all watched the same show or not. What is the dumbest anime series that you just absolutely adored, but is absolutely dumb and stupid?
Oh, God, I can tell you the one. There was one that I watched it, and I absolutely hated it. Like, I don't know if you guys have a My Anime List account.
I kind of do. I don't really update it, but...
Yeah, well, mine stays up to date, and this one here is the only anime I've ever given a score of a 1 to.
Okay, now I'm interested.
Yeah, Mazen Kaiser SKL. It was the dumbest 3-episode meathead, like, dumb, just, bro, they were just total bros in a mech. Like, it was the worst. The plot was stupid. The voice acting was terrible. Like, it felt like at any moment he would have said, yo, Chad, bro, you totally going to the mixer tonight? And I would have been like, yeah, that's the dialogue of this show. That... everything they were saying. It was just the worst. I've never given a score of a 1 to an anime until I watched that one. And I hated it. And I could not get those 3 episodes of my life back.
That fit the question, though. It was more
like... It was like, no, that is one where you say dumb to me. I cannot call a lot of stuff dumb and say I liked it. But yeah. I could what dumb one that I hated. That was the one I hated.
Yeah.
Man, I watch a lot of goofy stuff, so it's hard to say.
Yeah.
It was a dumb one, and I really, really liked it.
I don't know if this counts, because I don't feel like it's... I feel like the anime that I'm thinking of offhand, like, I could go over a list, my list of shit, but offhand, it's dumb in the way that the anime is portrayed, but it's intentionally done so, like... And yeah. I love anime for that, and that's Konosuba, because it's just like... Every fucking situation. I don't know if actually this is your show. Can we go explicit?
If you can keep it a little bit PG-13. I mean, technically you've been kind of going off on it. And I've not really stopped it there. I mean, as like at least a little bit of PG-13.
All right. So that anime is so friggin' dumb, but they do it intentionally. It's literally basically an anime satire. But
okay. So what is this? So what is the show now? I'm actually super curious now.
Konosuba,
God's blessing on the wonderful world or something like that.
Okay.
That one is very, very dumb, but it's done so intentionally because it's literally a satire. Like it's like.
Oh, Konosuba, man! I love that show.
I do too. That's what I'm saying. Like you. I think the question was a dumb show that you adore, and that's a dumb show I adore.
Yeah. So the dumb show that I absolutely adore, it's the dub that is the most amazing dub in the world, and if anyone ever says anything otherwise is 100% wrong, and that is Ghost Stories. Like, it's one of the dumbest things I have ever watched,
amazing.
And it's beautiful.
The can we say the greatest dub is that show? Like, you know it's terrible, and you know it's a tongue-in-cheek, and you know it is the greatest thing you will ever watch.
It is the greatest thing just because of the fact that every voice actor in there had to have a lot of fun. And the fact that most of these guys are doing these things, and it's like, they're not even in the same booth and doing this. It's like, the insanity, what's that word when people actually mesh together really well?
Oh, God, no, that was insanity. That show, you had it right when you said it the first time, because it was insane.
Well, it was insane, yes, but the thing is that they worked really well together.
Oh, God.
The entire cast worked off each other, like, really well.
Totally just matched off. And just the humor that it kept throughout, and for that you to just, it was basically like, here's a terrible anime. We know it's a terrible anime. And then they brought it over and they said, what can we do with it? And then the U.S. cast, they told them, go crazy.
Yeah.
And that was all they told them. And it was a masterpiece after that.
It was an absolute blast of fun. I mean, it was fun to watch it. Granted, I don't think it was as good. The later you go into it, the last few episodes, I don't think were as fun. Because I don't know if they were just getting overworked with it. They just weren't as funny as the ones in the beginning and the middle. Towards the end, it seemed like it just got, repetitive and just got annoying a little bit. I mean, there were still some funny moments in there, but it was just all it was starting to get really explicit and be like, It seems like they were just relying on that more so than, than what the middle was. The middle was amazing. The beginning was amazing, and then the ending was just not as good as the rest of it, but not terrible.
Well, I just added it to my Crunchyroll list because I noticed it has a 4.7 out of 5. That is impressive scoring.
Yes. Bro. It is amazing. It is one of the best things you ever watch.
People that don't even watch dubs tell you to watch the dub of this.
It's that good.
It's like, no, you don't watch the sub. You watch the dub of this show because the dub is the masterpiece. Dub is a masterpiece. Just hilarious. I don't even know. It was almost you think of films like Super Troopers and Black Dynamite, and you think of these independent comedies that became classics. Ghost Stories deserves to be in there as a classic comedy because it's just that off-the-rails just humor, and you're just like, did I just hear that said? The overly Christian girl that's through the whole movie that's condemning everybody to hell. She's amazing. It's just really, really funny. I love it.
Oh, yeah. It is one of those things that just man, I really do enjoy it. Granted, trying to find the DVD of it is really hard.
Oh, good luck. If you do find it, let me know.
Yeah. Because it's just let me know. I love it. I love it to death so much now. Now, granted, the movie I'm waiting for this year to come out, not to come out in theaters, but come out on DVD, and I'm still waiting for it. Let's see if they actually have it. I don't think Amazon has a time frame when it's actually going to get released. And that is Your Name. Which is being released this
November
year.
November 11th?
Is that coming out November 11th?
It's November something. I already have it on watch. Dude, I own the novelization. I'm going to be picking mangas. I am literally all in on Your Name.
Okay, here's the funny story about that. So when the movie was getting ready to come out, I plotted vacation from my job. So I work at Electronic Arts, the video game company. Yeah. So I had set it up a month or two in advance when I was taking this day off. I didn't know what was going on at that time. I just knew on that Friday, I won't be at work. And I set up the vacation. And then I kept telling all these guys, hey, where are you going to be that Friday? I'm taking this day off. Why? I'm going to see this movie. You guys got to find out about this movie. You got to see this movie. And I was a cheerleader for that film. And then De Lopez and our homeboy Jonathan, they decided, hey, we're going to go see this film. Coach is driving us crazy to go watch it. And then the phone does not quit ringing after that. Everybody, my cheerleader to it, went and watched it, comes out, this is the greatest film ever. And I was like,
yeah,
you.
I literally went and found the soundtrack on Google Play the instant after watching that movie and listened to it on the way home.
Nice.
That movie destroyed me. Actually, we did an episode on Is Your Name the greatest anime.
An episode about it.
Yeah. And
trust me, there has been on this podcast alone, we have done it. I think it was for a month straight. Nothing but Your Name. Was literally talking about, and every single episode of it, we were always talking about Your Name and Your Name and Your Name. And it's the fact that, it's at number, I think it reached at number 10. I think it reached at the 10th spot or just below, just right in the top 10 of the amount of money it made.
It's now.
It beat out Star Wars domestic in Japan, right?
Yeah, it did. It outperformed Star Wars the year it came out in Japan. Our thing was, you start looking at this film and it's even now, if you look at on the Crunchyroll most popular list, this locked in at number one now in the world.
Oh, easily. I could see it easily being the biggest thing there, because, I mean, as I said, the anime itself for the animation, yeah, anime, it reached a number 11 spot. So it didn't take a top 10 spot to, basically, it only was off by a very little amount for The Wind Rises that beat it out. And the only reason why The Wind Rises beat out Your Name is because it didn't have to go into as many theaters. Like, it only went into 311 theaters.
Yeah, and Your Name only had, like, 100,000...
No. I mean, the Your Name only had 311 versus The Wind Rises, which is about 496.
Oh, are you serious?
Yeah. So it wasn't as nearly as many theaters, but the really cool thing about Your Name and the fact that it still made $5 million here in the U.S.
Man, with no budget.
Well, $100,000.
Yeah, we said $100,000, I think. Yeah. That's no budget.
Yeah, basically no budget.
The budget. I think of the budget is probably somewhere up there. Like, I would say that budget was probably around.
What we're talking about.
Yeah, no. When we got into their marketing, we pulled before. They actually seriously had basically $100,000 U.S. The entire film, and we were like, "How do you market a film on $100,000 and still make
that?" Are you talking about Funimation, or are you talking about the creation of Your Name?
The creation, no,
not
your
the creation.
Name.
The creation had a bigger budget. The actual thing was only about $100,000. Shinkai talked about that himself. Like, the guy behind the movie talked about how they didn't have a big marketing. They didn't even expect it to be a big movie. He's a genius, though. Like, he is an amazing filmmaker, and he's super humble about it too. Like, he even talked about The Silent Voice being an amazing film, and he didn't even want to have to compare that to Your Name because he thought it was. I think he even said something like along the lines that he thought it was better than Your Name. Mm-hmm. But yeah, no, they only had about $100,000 to work with for marketing, and for what they did as far as like the actual box office numbers, like, it was extremely impressive for that low a marketing campaign fund.
But, you know, if we're going to talk about him being a genius, did you guys watch The Garden of Words?
I did not know.
Okay. So you have a High Dive account, right?
Yes, I do.
It's on there.
It's also on Amazon. I have it on my Amazon
list. It is. Anime Strike on Amazon does have this film. I will promise you this right now. If you want to see how we got Your Name, go watch A Garden of Words. You watch Garden of Words, and then you will understand why we got the genius that is Your Name. Because if A Garden of Words doesn't break you down, brother, you have no soul.
You know, the sad thing is, like, very little anime have actually made me cry. Like, almost to the point of almost making me cry. Like, Clannad came close, but, like, After Story kind of came a little bit close. Fullmetal Alchemist, the original Fullmetal Alchemist, almost did. It almost broke me.
Oh, wow.
Hey,
hold on. I'm thinking what made me cry.
Yeah.
Made me cry. Okay. Getting a lump in your throat doesn't count, right?
No. You actually have to shed tears. Because I've had a few times where I've had lumps in my throat and be like, this is really good. And it's just like, you know, very little. Actually, I would say the movie that almost made me cry, almost made me shed a tear, is The Fox and the Hound.
Oh.
When I rewatched that when I was younger, I was like, oh, yeah, it's a really fun movie. It's really nice. I remember it being really good. And then I got to the point where she had to leave Todd, and it was the saddest thing in the world to me. And it was like, it was sad. Like, it was just like, it's like, oh, my goodness, this is amazing. Like, that almost made me cry. But I did not cry. Like, it's very hard for me to actually legit cry for anything to get me to that point.
I think Your Name definitely had me, like, tearing up, but I don't anything ran down my cheek, so that's probably the teariest I've ever gotten. And it was legit, because, like, good lord, the climax to that movie just...
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my goodness.
How many times did you guys watch that film? Did you guys only watch it once?
Three, at least,
Three times. Okay, did you watch it both sub and dub, or did you watch it all sub?
All subbed. I plan on going back and watching it dub, because I heard that the English voice acting cast was actually pretty good.
Yes, it is. How about you, Coach?
I was once.
Okay, did sub or dub?
I did the sub.
Okay, you did the sub. Okay, so I watched it twice, and I watched it both sub and dub. Basically, it went there. at the morning of it, because I actually went to, because like, oh, I'm going to watch the dub. And I watched the sub. And it was really good. It was really good. So I came back the next day and watched the dub. So I watched back to back. And the thing about this is that your name throughout the entire thing, both the sub and the dub, are both great. Except the ending.
Uh-oh.
The ending of it, the last few words said, is something that, you know, I don't want to spoil the last few words there, because you guys know what it said, like, right at the end for the sub. Mm-hmm. It was the most powerful thing in the world. It was only two lines, and, oh no, it was three lines, it was three words, and it was the most powerful way for the movie to end.
Mm-hmm. I'm getting goosed thinking about it.
And, basically, the dub of that, it changed it. It just changed the wording of it. All it did was add another word in there for the first four letters there, and it just wasn't as impactful.
Hmm.
It was literally, they added another word, they moved some words around, and basically that's what you got with that. I don't want to spoil anything for anybody who has not seen it yet. Definitely check it out when it comes out in either probably November or sometime, I'm not sure, because I don't think Funimation has yet to release it.
Yeah, I mean, it's really weird, because I know one of the things that we were looking at on Amazon for it was that I know seeing all the, like, the UK dates for the Blu-ray and everything, and so we were like, are we going to have to import this from the UK just to get a physical copy of it? But
I doubt it.
It seems like there's been talk that it is, that date that came out is going to be the US Blu-ray date, too.
Mm-hmm. Okay, what's the UK Blu-ray date?
I want to say that's where we get the November 11th is where it's coming from, because I know if you go...
November 6th is what Amazon UK says the release date is.
November 6th?
Yeah. It says this title will be released on November 6th, 2017. Pre-order now.
Yep.
Which that didn't surprise me at all. I mean, how much is the Blu-ray for it?
£14.99, or pounds, it looks like, for the UK release.
Which is, I don't even know.
It's about like $17 bucks US.
No, okay. Because it's probably for your name. I'm probably going to wind up getting the limited edition for it.
Oh, God. Yeah, I'm getting whatever box comes with everything.
I mean, it's one of those films that I can see myself spending $100 on easy just because it's of the title alone. And be like, is it worth it? Yeah, it's worth it.
I start throwing my money at Makoto Shinkai. Just like...
Yeah, basically, just like, yeah, do you take checks?
Just like, I will follow you around just writing these and making it rain on you. With me.
Yeah. I mean, the film itself has actually made a pretty good amount of money. I mean, just going back with, you know, how much it actually made, how much it grossed worldwide, was about $355 million. And that's worldwide.
That's impressive. That's getting close to that 400 mil mark that people look for in, like, Hollywood box office hits.
Oh, yeah. I mean, domestically, it did amazing. And not domestically. Domestically, it didn't do as well. But I imagine, you know, how much well it could have done now, because Funimation is partnered up with Sony Pictures, which makes me really happy, because of the fact that they're going to get more and more, because of how well Your Name did. I'm hoping to get more and more films like Your Name, more anime films into more theaters, where, you know, Pokemon was and Yu-Gi-Oh was, to where it's like, just throw it out in theaters and hopefully it does well.
Yeah.
And I'm hoping that's what Sony Pictures does with Funimation. A lot
more traditional animated films, like Your Name was not like hardcore digitally remastered or anything. It was like very traditional done, and it looked gorgeous for it.
Oh yeah, that's the thing. The reason why I love anime so much is the fact that. Anime is such an interesting thing where 2D animation is still king there. It's still, you know, you see a lot of, even though I do see some series that use a combination of 3D and CG, most of the time it fails horribly.
Mm-hmm.
And it just doesn't work. A few times it does work, like Gundam series.
Yeah.
That does actually work because they keep the Gundams, you know, as a 3D model while they keep the, characters as the 2D model, so it's not like they keep switching in and out where the, I think this is where the characters, where they switch out the characters that were 2D and they make them 3D and then they go back to 2D. I think that's where it really has some issues.
Yeah, I agree.
So you want to talk about something from what was that?
I think I know what made me cry.
What made you cry?
Erased.
Erased?
Erased. I cried.
Oh. Interesting.
I did cry on Erased. I got through that whole series. Did you guys watch it?
It's on my list.
I did not. I've watched a little bit of it.
Mm-hmm.
It's one of those series where I'm kind of ashamed to say, like, I never actually finished it. Just because I had so many other series to watch at the time. And it's like, I know it's really good, and it's amazingly good.
Yeah, it was the only, I think it's the only series in the last, like, when I give out scores, like, I have very few, like, perfect scores of 10s that I've given out. The Words got a 10 from me. Your Name got a 10 from me. A Silent Voice got a 9 from me. Erased got a 10. I had not
seen
a series where I was like, I can't knock this series. I'm like you. I watched the series and then went and bought all the soundtrack for it.
Man.
Wow.
You know, so it was one of those things where I fell into this series.
Yeah.
Bought into the storyline 100%. It was the one that got me to cry.
Nice.
Like,
yeah, it's not nice, but I mean, yeah.
Yeah, no, it was.
Actually,
cry my life.
Yeah, if you're talking about anime that I've actually wanted to buy the soundtrack for, mm-hmm. is there's only one anime I've really wanted the soundtrack for, and that's been Yuri on Ice. Is I really want the soundtrack for this series. It's amazing. It's an amazing series.
Oh.
The music for it is absolutely dynamite.
Yeah, I can't say anything. I have a lot of those songs.
Yeah.
I seriously have a lot of those songs.
There was just a ton of work that went into that series, and it was, like, probably one of the best series. It was one of the best series from last year. Hands down. Easily be the one of the best series that I've ever watched.
The piano theme, Yuri on Ice, that, you know, Yuri skates, mm-hmm. young Yuri. I bought that when the soundtrack hit iTunes, and put it on what I call my life soundtrack. It's like that song is the theme song. Like, if they made a movie about my life, I want that piano part to play. That's all my great moments. Like, when I'm getting ready to walk across the stage in graduation and it's in slow motion, that song should be playing. Yeah. The first time my virginity, that song should be playing.
Oh my gosh, I don't need to have that image in my head.
Yeah, it was a epic moment. Oh, just God. Like when the Yuri on Ice theme plays, and it's like, he's going for the gold.
Oh, boy, where have we gone here? I don't even know where we've gone.
I have no idea. That was a PG-13. That was my one time going to the line of PG-13.
I know. I'm aware of that. It's just like, oh, why?
I'm going to come up to the line, and I'm going right back down to G-rated. Like, okay, it was a nice bit to the PG-13, bye.
No, but it's very interesting, though, when you look at all the anime that has come out in the past, I want to say in this past year, the past few, I've been doing, basically we've been doing the podcast since about 2014, since the winter of 2014.
Mm-hmm.
I would say is when we actually started it, and since then... anime there for 2014, 2015, beginning of 2015, there really wasn't much good series. Until, basically we hit last year, where there's been contenders for the number one anime of the year throughout the entire year, where it's like, okay, maybe this series is going to be the new anime of the year, because this is actually my new favorite now. And oh, this is my new favorite. Oh, dang it, this is my new favorite. And where pretty much I think the bulk of everyone's favorite anime of the year really comes from the fall and the summer. Mostly the fall anime is kind of interesting that most of the anime that, you know, is my anime of the year is usually coming in the fall. Very rarely is it the summer. Hmm. Now, granted, it was the summer for, I think it was either spring or summer for, I think 2014 was... The World Is Still Beautiful. I actually own that series because it's an amazing series. It's never been dubbed. Sentai has not yet to dub it yet, but it's still a really good series. And I think 2015 was... I'm trying to think what 2015 was. Because it's 2017 now. Okay, 2015 was a fall series, which was between One Punch Man and Chivalry of a Failed Knight. And Chivalry of a Failed Knight won out instantly with one moment in that series. which was the best moment in an entire series, where you don't really get to see very often in anime and actually any entertainment. When you look at entertainment and all that stuff, where basically, have you guys seen Chivalry?
No.
No, it's on my list.
Before my time, big in the anime again.
No, Chivalry, it's available on High Dive as well. The dub is actually, all the dub is available there. But it's at one point in the series where it's towards the end of it, because a lot of it was, oh, this is just fan service. This is just, you know, another anime fan service thing. Okay, cool. It's not bad. It was, you know, it wasn't anything that I thought was amazing at the time. But then I kind of looked at it and it was like, you know, they were basically in a house together where she was basically coming out to him to where basically she was saying, you want to do it. And he flat out tells her no. And the reason for that is the fact that he didn't want to sully her family name.
Aww.
And it's something like that was just hit me in a way where it was just like, wow, I don't really see that ever in an anime series. Like, in entertainment in general, you look at Hollywood in general, you don't see that. And that's something that hit hard, and it's like, you can't beat that. This guy is the true gentleman, and granted, in any other series, he would be, you know, be like, ah, yeah, you're just a wimp, you don't want to do it because you're just a wimp, ah. You know, he would be seen as the weird one in anything, but the fact that it's such a strong moment between these two characters, and the fact that she says, oh, good, you're serious about our relationship, is something to that. It's a testament to that series. And the fact that, you know, I really wish more series, more entertainment was like that. To where it's like, oh, you don't have to do it. And why are you doing it? Because that's what we're supposed to do?
Right.
And it's something that, you know, it's like, it makes it really strong. And, you know, in any entertainment, like, the only time you would ever probably see it happen like that is in a Christian movie.
Mm-hmm.
And, I mean, let's face it, that's most of the time where you're going to see it at. Like, Hollywood isn't going to do that.
Right.
And if Hollywood actually came out with a movie that did that, I think it would have been an interesting film because I would like to see some of the reactions from it. Whether they would say, oh, yeah, this is actually kind of strong, or, yeah, this is stupid, this is horrible, why are we doing this? Because that one movie, though, was really good, especially if you're looking at, you know, you want a strong male lead and you want a strong female lead. And the fact that they both have issues. And the fact that they come together and they pretty much erase their weaknesses together and basically become really two strong characters that have, you know, that have weaknesses but make up for each other when you look at the characters. And that's something that I love to see. I love strong female leads. I love strong male leads. And I love them when they're together, and the fact that, you know, when they work off each other really well, it's something that I love to see. Oh. I think it makes them more dynamic characters than when it's like, oh, yeah, they're just there to, you know, be your... She's just there to look good.
That waifu material.
Yeah.
They're so... She's just a piece of cardboard. That's all she could be.
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of times, that's how they write a lot of female characters.
I mean, even when they have strong female leads, like... Say, for instance, Croissant is one where they have a really strong female lead, but the male character that winds up, you know, really liking her is not as strong. It's basically he gets run over by her multiple times, and he's basically a wimp, and he's just her lap boy. And it's just like, you know, it's like I love to have characters that are, you know, equally as strong, but that's the reason why I like The World Is Still Beautiful. Both of them have their faults, but their female character doesn't particularly need the male guy, and the male guy can fend for herself, same for him as well, but together they're an unstoppable force.
I'm gonna definitely have to mess with it now.
Yeah,
watch it.
I have converted him to the watching. You know, the world is still beautiful and Chivalry. Apparently.
Yeah, but here's the thing that gets me, like, when we start making strong contenders for seasons, winter 2016, I was showing Zain, winter 2016 gave us Erased, Tsuba, Assassination Classroom second season. There was, I don't know if you guys did Dimension W.
Oh, my.
Oh, Dimension W, yes, it was actually really good, but it just wasn't as... like, say, when you're looking at the strong contenders from 2016, because you had One Punch Man, you had Chivalry, were the two top contenders for me personally.
Mm-hmm.
And they just, it was up there, but it just wasn't as good as, say, a lot of times when I look at the anime, like, anime of the year for me personally, it hasn't had the connection for me. And that's kind of the way I look at it, in that, you know, if it has a really good connection, if it's not a second season, it's all fair game. So second season, that's the reason why Assassination Classroom second season, kind of, I wanted to make an exception to put it on the list, be like, it's part of the top 10, easy. Because it's like, do I want to do that? Because it's like so many other series is that, you know, they already, this Assassination Classroom already had an established base, so.
Yeah, like Raced locked it up for me that year. Mm-hmm. It wiped out everything. But that year, I was also doing, like, I can tell you, you know, Konosuba came out and it caught fans. Like, it caught on.
Yeah.
And like, they picked up followings. Another one that I liked was Iron-Blooded Orphans. I don't know how many of you guys got into that whole mobile suit.
I started watching it a little bit during the dub, during the Toonami run. I just kind of stopped watching it because it's like I just kept forgetting to watch it.
I think the problem with Iron-Blooded Orphans is that it wasn't like so much a Gundam series as much as it was a drama. Like, there was a lot of...
It was a Game of Thrones at one point. It was like, don't get attached to any of these guys. He's dead. And you're like, no, he isn't. He's gonna be. He's a main character. Bro, he dead. It Game of Thrones a lot of characters. And I just kind of thought, like, when I kept telling friends, you know, that were watching it, like, one of my friends said, is it a feels fest? And I was like, how do you feel about Game of Thrones? And he went, oh, my God, I hate it because everybody I love dies. Don't watch this show. Skip over.
You know what's hilarious is I've not watched a single episode of Game of Thrones.
We just talked about this, man. It's how I'm the guy that has not watched it. And, you know, but it was just definitely one of the things where it's like, I probably should be better about sitting down and getting caught up.
Yeah. I'm guilty too. It's okay.
Well, there's so much stuff to watch in such a little time that you have to watch it. It's like, do I want to watch some anime? Because I know if I start watching an anime, then it just turns into the thing of like, I continue binge watching it until the end, especially if the entire series is out. I will sit down and just watch it. And do nothing. I had a
problem recently with two particular anime, actually.
Yeah.
School Live and Madoka Magica.
Oh my gosh. I love
it. Oh my goodness.
I think I may have got you into School Live, and I'm sorry for that one.
No, they both killed me so much. I actually bought posters for both of them because of how much I wanted to cry when I go into my room.
One anime in particular that I actually picked up that was kind of a blast from the past when I watched it. My cousin actually had the series, and I started watching it last night, and it was amazing. Was Scribe?
I remember that
one from forever.
And what's hilarious is that you look at the names of people who are still in this, people who actually did voices in it, and there's only three people out of the entire cast that are still working with anime.
Are you serious?
I believe so. They're still relatively big names. You have Tony Oliver.
Mm-hmm.
You have Steve Bloom.
Mm-hmm.
And you have Crispin Freeman.
Oh, okay.
That have all worked with Scribe, and it's amazing. The fact that, you know, they're all their characters are amazing in that series. But it's kind of interesting to see, you know, the fact that as a dubbing gets older and older and older, the fact that you see the people that have been there for a while... the people who, you know, have stayed on and you have kept working on with anime all the way through. I mean, Tony Oliver's been working with anime for years at this point.
Yeah, man, you know, that shocks me when we thought about that, like, at Anime CTX. Mm-hmm. Talking to, you know, like, Jessica Cavello and Jewel and Lisa Ortiz, and then you start realizing... You know, especially for me as a guy in the industry, you know, in the video game industry and just being a fan of anime and doing the show, it's just now that I'm starting to realize a lot of these, I'm growing up with them. Like when you start finding out, hey, we're all the same age. We're growing up together and they're still in the business and I'm still talking about it. So it's kind of been neat to just kind of, I mean, there's a camaraderie that I think I developed with a lot of them this summer. Where going to the cons and, you know, doing the show and interviewing them and sitting across, and I got to, you know, yeah, I'm interviewing them, but I'm interviewing you from the point of a fan that's watched you grow in this industry. So
yeah, which makes it kind of interesting for personally for me when I'm actually getting a chance to sit down with some of these guys is that not so much with like say Jerry and Jessica as much as it was with because both of them are awesome, both of them are really cool, but the shows that they were in. Really, you know, I didn't really grow up. They weren't a series that I really grew up with. I mean, Jessica a little bit more because she worked with Pokemon. But I would say with Lisa Ortiz is one that I've actually grown up with, not really realizing who she was, you know, this entire time. You know, who she's actually played in Pokemon. The fact that she's been working with Pokemon since Indigo League.
Yeah.
And the fact that you look at that entire thing and you go, wow, I've actually grown. Basically, Pokemon came out when I was about 5 or 6.
Ooh.
Came out in 95, 96, I believe that's when it came out. And then I think it was 95 because I remember it being this big, huge thing when Pokemon came out that, like, everybody was saying, oh, it's the devil's thing. Ah, it's pocket monsters. That's bad.
Yeah.
And I got kind of caught into that because of, you know, I was going, my parents and were going to church, we still do. And the fact that it kind of was like, oh, Pokemon is bad. So to watch Pokemon, I kind of had to sneak watch it. And it was a lot of the anime. I actually had to sneak watch a lot of anime because my parents didn't like anime. Now, granted, I think my mom knew the fact that I was watching anime, the fact that I was watching Yu-Gi-Oh, Pokemon, and the fact that, you know, it's, hey, we're watching it. And that, you know, it's like my dad didn't really like that much. Like it that much for anime wise. Mm-hmm. But it's something that I've kind of kept with. And the fact that, you know, the love for anime since the beginning of Pokemon all the way through now is just actually increased. And the fact that we want to, you know, work with cons now. The fact that to be around the industry right now. And the fact that right now it's the strongest that it's ever been.
Oh, yeah.
You look at Funimation, you look at Sentai. I mean, for Funimation, for crying out loud, is the simuldubs. You can tell that the simuldubs, not only is it the fact that not like the old Funimation where it's like, oh, it's the same voices again and again and again. Oh, it's Vic Mignogna, it's Kyle Hebert. You know, this person, that person. You know, Sonny Strait. Oh, he's in there again. Now it's a diverse cast. You look at the entire cast list for all the simuldubs, and you might see one or two names the same.
Yeah.
But you look at the entire simuldub list, cast list, you won't find maybe two or three of them have the same actor in there. But very rarely you're going to see another actor in there that is in a prominent role in that series.
Well, I'll tell you the one.
Over two or three times.
New Game. And I know you just started watching it, but I did New Game season one in, I did the sub of it and I watched the sub of season two. And then I just saw the cast list for the dub.
Yeah.
And I did not recognize any of these women, but I was so fascinated that I didn't know anybody on the show that I was like, I now have to go watch this dub. Who are these young guns that are in here playing these roles? Because I love this series.
Yeah.
New Game, but it was nice seeing new names that are coming into the industry. And
It was, actually, I can tell you some of these names here. Michelle Rojas, she's been in a few.
She did?
I don't remember, but Tia Ballard's been in Funimation for a really long time, along with Caitlin Glass as well. Both of them have been around.
Thing that they did, though, that's what kills me. It's like,
I can look that up. Hold on. I'm at Wikipedia, the next best thing to Anime Network.
Oh, you're so right. You are so right.
And then, let's see here. See if there is any other names that are pumping out to me. Other than that, some of them are relatively new, but I mean, Tia Ballard's been in... Oh, frick. She's been in a ton of stuff. She's been in Strike Witches, Rosario Plus Vampire, Fullmetal Alchemist Brotherhood.
That I watched.
Fairy Tale.
Fairy Tale, yeah.
But see,
she was happy in Fairy Tale.
I skipped around Fairy Tale, but she was...
Attack on Titan. The Devil's a Part-Timer. Log Horizon. Gangsta.
She got
Prison School.
Those last four goodness. You named right there, I did the subs, and I never saw the dubs of any.
Seraph of the End. Dimension W, she's also in that.
Who is she? W.
What?
In Dimension
Mina
Really?
Yeah. Mita. Mana.
Who?
I think it's Mana?
The Android girl?
No, she wasn't the android. I don't believe she was
the android. Okay, Mita is the android girl.
The stuff she's worked on, like, and you thought there was never a girl online. I mean, I can go, the names kind of keep going on. And
so she did a lot of the big series when they did the dubs for them.
Yes. And then Galen Glass has
been around. My dub game up.
Yeah, because Galen Glass has been around forever. She's been in Case Closed, Full Metal Alchemist. She was Winry in that. Spiral. Burst Angel. Neon Genesis, Genesis of Aquarian, Gunslinger Girl, Dragon Ball Z, Bio Broly, Shin-Chan. I mean, I should tell you the fact that of how old, I mean, she was even in Tsubasa Reservoir Chronicles, Claymore. She's been in forever. I'm actually kind of surprised you just never have heard of the name before.
Well, here's what it is. A lot of the stuff that she did dubs for, I watched subbed of.
Oh.
And that is really what the problem starts for. I think that's one of the weird things is, you know, man, I was so, like, at one point, I'm never going to say I was the guy that was like, I'll never watch a dub. No, I totally will watch a dub. I just think that a lot of time when it came to me, especially when I was traveling, you know, like I was in the military and I was overseas, you kind of get, you know. So you're, when we were in Singapore, It's a huge sub market when I was in Singapore.
Yeah.
So it's just you're gonna get everything. I'm just gonna get these, you know, subtitles in English, and I'm just glad to be able to watch this. And so a lot of that stuff that I kind of came into was like, hey, I'm just getting sub. And then when I got back to the States, I mean, really, like in the last year, there have been a lot of series where I was like, hey, you know, I'm only going to be able to get the dub of this, but I'm going to watch it because I want to see it. Now, like, on Ice, I did the sub, but I really was familiar with the male cast of a lot of the guys that did the dub.
Yeah.
I was like, I'm going to support that. So I watched it. You know, I wanted to see
it. Yeah.
And it was
what's really interesting, though, when you look at dubs, and I still look at it, and I say, you know, if anybody who has a bad thing about, says anything bad about dubs, I will show them Yuri on Ice. I will show them side by side the sub versus the dub. And the fact that you will see the basically, you actually know, you'll understand, you know, exactly what I'm saying here, is the fact that it was almost like they ripped it straight from they ripped the dub straight from the sub.
Oh, yeah.
No, it was that
cool. That's an amazing dub.
Yes.
I'm never going to knock that one. Now, one of my favorite series, which you guys named in that list that she was on, is, and you wonder if there's ever a girl online, probably one of my in my top 10 romantic comedies, you know, for, like, just super funny and hilarious.
Oh, my goodness, it's so stupid. The thing is, for the dub, though, she's very whiny. She's very, it's intentionally done that way, but because of the fact that it's so intentionally done that way, I can see a lot of people having issues with it because
I'm gonna give it a give it a shot. I'll see.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah,
definitely give it a shot. But man, yeah, I definitely, that was one that I was 100% sub on that, and it was just one of those things where it's like I fell in love with that series. But it's one I've seen it, like when I opened up Funimation and I saw it in there, I was like, you know, I really need to watch that again. And plus, I love Lucy, who did that first song, My First Love Story. And yes, I own that song. Yeah. I do.
Of course.
I do. I have no problem playing, like, cute Japanese girl songs. You know, and I can sing it.
Oh,
man.
Oh, boy. Abandoned ships, guys. Abandoned ships.
Yeah, I know.
There's a weeb on board.
Bro, I was actually doing the dance like this, dude. You know what?
The one thing is that I would honestly just love the hilarious thing just to see you doing the Japanese-type dances. It just would be like the... I don't know, the greatest thing in the world right now. I don't know why that would be. That would make me laugh, but I think that would actually make me laugh right
now. Bro, earlier this week, that song got stuck in my head. So when I came to work, I was sitting at my desk and I was like, hey, I have this in my For When I'm Sad folder on YouTube. Like, I have a folder full of songs like this. And as I had my headset on, I'm not realizing that I'm doing this little... You can't see this hands. Just like, why are you doing this dance? And I was like, I was doing that dance. And it was just like, And I just kind of remember turning around and Brandon's looking at me like, you are no longer a man. And you know, you just know.
Do you know how many times I've lost my man card at this point? Uh-oh. It's been like, I lose it constantly, daily. It's a daily loss, losing thing.
They took my card. I watched them set it on fire. It was just...
Oh, trust me. My card was in the mail, and then they saw who it was coming to, and then they just went, no.
Yeah, it was not good.
It was refundable, basically. It was non-refundable, and they just took it out of the mail.
Yeah, it was terrible. And I was singing along with the song, and it was like, why do I even know this in Japanese? How much have I listened to this song that I sing along to it in my car? That's sad. Okay, yeah, it's one of those songs. I don't care.
So, I don't know how many of you guys are actually familiar with Gundam Seed and Gundam Seed Destiny.
I'm definitely, I like to say I'm very familiar with it, because I think you've dealt with either Seed or Seed Destiny at one point.
Yeah.
Whether you realized it or not, you've watched it.
Yeah. I mean, I've watched all of it. I've watched from Seed and Seed Destiny. Now, what's really interesting, though, is that something was happening right now where I'm, like, going, like, I was on Twitter, and I'm, like, going, like, what? They're redubbing Seed and Seed Destiny? Why? And then finding out that it did HD remasters of it. And now I'm curious to see, you know, what's the difference between the HD remaster versus the actual Gundam Seed.
Yeah, I remember watching it way back in the day. I think it was on Toonami or something.
Yeah.
Yeah, I remember watching it way back dubbed.
I mean, I love... probably one of my favorite animes from the Gundam series is Wing. And Hiro Yui being one of the best lines in the world. The fact that he rips it the best way possible. I don't know, have you guys seen Wing?
I've not. I have a friend who's like obsessed with Gundam, and I think we might have to do a Gundam episode with Warren one of these days.
Nice.
What
about you, Mitch?
Yeah, now I've watched. Gundam is my jam, bro.
Okay, so you watched the dub of that then?
Of Wing.
Okay, basically, Hiro basically takes her.
That's
basically
card.
Yeah, and just basically says, "I will kill you."
I have watched.
Like, that. I'm gonna kill you, and it's the best line possible because he says it with the straightest face, and it is like the most badass line. It's the dumbest line, but it's so cool.
I'm gonna tell you something. This is a series that in dub that did not hold up well. Like when you go back and watch it as an adult, you're like, what was I thinking when I was a kid?
Oh, I still love it. I mean, are you kidding me? I still enjoy Gundam Wing. It's one of those series is, the dub may not be the best, but, like, when you have dubs like this, dubs like Gundam Wing, and the fact that you look at something like Versus to Where Yuri on Ice, and the fact that you look at these two dubs, and the fact that how far we've come since that dub... To right here, it's, like, it's amazing how far we've come.
But, man, I just remember this series. Like, there were so many lines like that in that...
but like, it made it so great.
My favorite is the one where he shoots at Hiro... And, like, grazes him. And in the, like, Princess Relena, I think was her name, and she jumped.
It was Relena.
Was it Relena?
It was Relena, yeah.
Relena? Okay.
Trust me. There's one thing I actually know. Hiro Yui, Relena, and then Hiro, I want to say Hiro Maxwell? Duel Maxwell was the other one that I really remember.
And I remember she jumps in front of him, don't shoot him. And he went, what? And now I'm the bad guy? And I just remember just watching this and go, this is terrible. This
is Duo, though. That was actually Duo's line right there. I can tell you that right there.
You know what I'm talking about. And I just, this did not hold up well. But I remember being younger and just thinking, all these guys are Han Solo. They're all just bad.
They're all Han Solo.
But no, the thing is that my two favorite Gundams is the Death Scythe.
Yes.
And Gundam, and basically Gundam Wing.
Yes.
Is the two right there. Oh my goodness. I absolutely adore those two Gundams together. They're like, Death Scythe is cool. Duo Maxwell is just hilarious throughout the entire series. Hiro is just like, he's a very bland character, but his lines, he has some pretty badass lines, not gonna lie. He has some really cool lines.
I could tell you this. If they would have ever made a live-action movie in the 80s of that show, Hiro would have been played by Jean-Claude Van Damme.
Oh, my God.
I would literally be okay with that.
That was how it sounded. Like, it was so stiff, some of his lyrics. Like,
yeah.
Did it come to my party? No. I will kill you. And I was just like,
oh,
that's a cold line. Like, I still tell people that, but, like, nowadays, the police would be called. Reject, like, are you coming to my kid's birthday party? No, I will kill you. And just walk away. Just, like, rip the whole invitation up and walk away. Like, I'm a...
I mean, honestly, if you did that, though, I actually kind of want to do that now. I want to go up to, like, have somebody come up to me and just say no. And literally just no. Not even say no. Just rip up the invitation and says, I'm going to kill you. And just walk away.
And just walk away. And just, like...
It's just,
and you hear,
like, how many times would you all of a sudden be like, it was a prank, it was a prank, cops, it was just a prank.
Like, I'm pulling up my anime account right now. It's just like, look, officer, I need you to watch this real quick.
Be like, while you're, you know, putting me into the back seat, just watch this, please.
Watch.
I'm honestly, what are you doing with a taser? No, just watch this,
I need you to watch this so you'll know what I was telling him. It's so good. Yeah, I'm just like,
it's just like,
it didn't.
The reaction is something that would be interesting to see. Like, if somebody did that and I just did that just for kicks and giggles. And the fact that most people who know me know the fact that, you know, most of the time what I'm doing is not serious. Like, very rarely am I actually legit being serious.
Mm-hmm.
And the fact that, you know, most, if I did that to anybody that knew me, would be like, why are you? We know that you're going to be there. This is why. Are you being an idiot?
That's brilliant to me. I just want a camera trained on you when you do it. So we go. He won.
Be like,
he won.
Be like, I think that might be a little bit curious. But them with camera in their face would be like, what are you doing? Nothing.
Yeah.
While you're ripping it.
I need you to hand me that invitation on camera. Go. Yeah, that's it. I would love that, because that'd be me. I'd be like, yeah, cool. I got to do this. I got to get this in one take.
And then 20 takes later, you finally get what you wanted.
Yeah.
Okay, and all their invitations are gone. They got to go print new ones.
Yeah, they're just giving me, like, junk mail. That doesn't even look like a flyer that they gave you. Like, that's for aluminum siding. Oh, you. And I'm just tearing it up.
And they give you a phone book and you just keep tearing that?
Oh, man, I can do this. That's going to be my jam. In 2018, that happened to me.
Well, 2018 is literally the year of ripping up things.
No, I'm going to have to wait to 2019. I gotta go to some things in 2018 before I start ripping them up. I got to get on to party list in 2018 to start ripping them up in 2000.
So your only goal in 2018 is to be to the point where people are inviting you to parties and giving you invitations to parties, so that way you can start going, no, I'm going to kill you.
Yeah.
I'm going to kill you. No, I'm going
to
kill you.
I only think I'm going to have to do two of them. I'm going to have to make the first two count before everybody's like, don't invite Coach. He's killing people and he's not coming to the party. He's really in a weird, dark spot. Yeah, I feel like
How did we get on the subject? Oh, I know how we got on the subject. It's Gundam Wing and talking about that and talking about the insanity that is Gundam Wing, and it's such a great series. The movie itself is amazing too.
Have ADD also, that helps.
Yeah, well, I'm all over the place too, so it doesn't really help anything. I mean, poor Zain is just over there going like, I don't know what's going on. They're talking about an anime series. I think I know it. It's something there. I'm just going, maybe they might shut up. I'm
it
not sure.
Actually is on Hulu. The dub is on Hulu.
Oh my goodness.
But yes, bro,
What's really interesting, though, is the dub for Erase is on Hulu now. A lot of Aniplex stuff is on Hulu.
They got the dub for Erase down there?
Mm-hmm.
Ooh.
A lot of their dubs are now available on Hulu, so for Aniplex. So I thought that was actually really cool.
You might need to check that out, bro.
Yeah, probably.
You need to check that out.
The one thing that's really nice about the anime stuff, though, that's on Hulu, very rarely do they actually have, even if you don't have the subscription where you don't get any ads or anything like that.
Mm-hmm.
Most of the time, those don't have ads because they're short enough and everything. They're not gonna have the ads to them until you get into, like, you know, say like MasterChef or dealing with those stuff, and then it's just like, yeah.
I will tell you this much: if you want to watch a great rom-com that I do know is on there, and it's Sentai Filmworks, Amagami SS.
Amagami.
Amagami. Amagami. I want to say that's Amag. Yeah.
Okay, Amagami SS.
Yeah.
I believe the... Well, it's also available on High Dive as well.
Is it?
Yes.
Man, see, High Dive's going to mess around and be catching you slipping again, man.
I feel like... Well, they have a lot of stuff. As I said, they have a lot of series on there. Like, their series are a pretty good amount. Like, their movies are relatively good as well. Like, some movies that they don't have, I don't think they have the movie for... I don't think they have all of their films on there. But, like, say OVAs are considered part of the films that are on there. So I don't really consider that a film. But they even have Elfin Lied, the dub for that, The Garden of Words.
Yes.
They
have great the dub for Fireflies.
That. Yes.
Oh,
the dub.
My goodness. Okay, want to watch a movie that's going to tear your heart out?
That's it right there.
Always?
Yeah, watch this one.
Like, if I can just have an anime literally slice me open and show me my beating heart, like...
Well, I think we just named the show for you, because, man, there's some shows out there, like, we could do...
Yeah.
We've been talking about doing an episode about this, like, we like to... For our Taku Lounge, we've been kind of picking apart stuff that we go, hey,
yeah,
let's do a theme show. And that's one that we're looking at. Is one, we talked about doing a rom-com show with a friend of ours named Belly, which I think is going to be a riot.
But, yeah.
And I'm really going to show my girly side on that. I'm just, just really going to get
I'll
in touch.
I'll just take the man card now.
Oh, yeah, bro. Like, I'm going to give you moves.
Do,
like,
do you even have it at this point?
Or
he's lost his man card.
Yeah, no. Well, I had, and I was married. So at this point, it's just like my daughters are like, Dad, I want to go see this movie. What are we going to see? The Notebook. And it's my wife's favorite film, and she made me watch it with her.
Yeah.
And then, like, when I watched it, like, I'm not saying I cried during the first time I saw it. What happened was, I was eating a pickle and I bit into it and it squeezed juice in my eye and then
actually, the film that was actually really good and is really good, the first 5 minutes make the film and you could walk out easily and be satisfied. I think it was the first first 5 minutes, and that's Up.
Oh, God, yeah.
And Up is the first 5 minutes alone. You could be satisfied with the entire film, and that was it. If that was the entire film, Pixar was saying, oh, we only have 5 minutes of this film, and that was it, I would say, yeah, worth it to go see it again.
Yeah, no, that's a relationship, bro. Yeah. Carl and Ellie, at the start of Up, bro, like, I'm going into Up with my kids, and I'm like, oh, this is going to be so much fun, and this grouchy old man, and this
Boy
Scout, this is going to be cute. Then I get the first 5 minutes in this film, and I'm like, what the hell, Disney? Really? With my emotions,
I mean,
like
Pixar.
This for my children, okay?
Be this big, strong guy, and then all of a sudden, first 5 minutes in, why, Disney? I hate you, I love you, I hate you at the same time.
Like, my daughter's pat me on my hand, Daddy, it's okay. No, it's, I got butter for this popcorn in my eye.
Yeah. No, it was a movie that my mom even cried in. It was pretty darn good. I mean, let's face it, it was a great film.
Okay.
And oh my goodness, you could talk about forever with Disney, and you go into Disney a lot, and then kind of almost trying to get back into anime now. And it's like the options of anime are so endless at this point. It's just you don't know a lot of times you just don't know where to go.
Yeah, there's like so many
especially,
exclusives too. Like you have to have this subscription to watch this, or you have to.
I mean,
tune in here.
Even for you, Zain. Like, say when you first started to get back into it, like how intimidating was it to actually try to get back into, like really getting it when you first got into anime and trying to figure out, okay, where do I go next? What do I watch next?
It wasn't terribly hard. It was just like what I want to pay money for. So, like, last year, Netflix I had Gurren Lagann. I also actually had I think it was like a month free from, what's it called, whoever brought Dimension W over. I watched that set through there.
That
was Funimation.
Funimation.
Yeah.
So I had a Funimation account for a hot minute. Then I just picked up Crunchyroll and like watched. I've watched so many anime. I wish that I had been watching on time, like the Monogatari series. I'm catching up still, and they're coming. They're apparently coming out with a new season of Monogatari in the fall. So Awari. I have Awari season 2.
Yeah.
So I have to catch. I have to finish up Nisei. I have to watch Neko. I have to watch. Awari 1. There's another season I think in there I have to watch, so yeah, I have to catch up to
this
that.
This is where I say get on my level, because you know where I'm going.
But yeah, no, like, getting back into anime in the last year, it wasn't terribly daunting. Like, I did have, like, to make some choices on where I wanted to put my money, so Crunchyroll has it, Netflix has had my money for years.
Yeah.
I need to. Oh, I just actually got an Amazon Prime and started Strike. They have some exclusives I can't get anywhere else.
The thing is about Anime Strike.
Oh god.
I don't like Anime Strike. I hate Anime Strike.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason why I kind of had this agent for Anime Strike is the fact that you have to pay so much money for it, and to tell people, oh, it's worth it, it's worth the price, because you get so many good animes, it's like, not really.
Yeah, no, I was looking at the list.
Because a lot of the simulcasts, for instance, Is It Wrong to Pick Up Girls in a Dungeon, I'm trying to find it now, Sword Arida, that's what it is, I believe is available on High Dive. I believe so. Might be wrong on that one.
Y'all are kind of selling me on this High Dev thing.
Yeah. I mean, Sword Arida, I don't know if it's when it's actually getting added to it, but...
Is It Wrong to Pick Up Girls in a Dungeon was also on Crunchyroll simulcast, so...
Yeah.
But
that's been on there for a while, so it's like...
Yeah.
But one thing's really cool is that... Is It Wrong to Pick Up Girls in a Dungeon, I believe that dub is available on High Dive as well.
Interesting.
Hold on. I can tell you. As I got the list pulled up, let me see. A, B, C, D.
It's there.
D, A, yep.
I believe the dub is available on that as well.
Nice.
There it is.
Like, a lot of their new dubs, yeah. I believe so. Let me double check that. I can double check that really quick.
This is one of the hottest soundtracks. Kids on the Slope was a jazz show.
Yeah.
Oh, my.
Yep, it is English dubbed. So I can actually
There's 217 dubs on this thing.
That's another one I need to watch right there. Is Love
dubs on what?
Another Delusion.
On High Dive.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm.
There's no way that has that many, is there?
Yeah, I just actually set it to, unless this is wrong, all I did is clicked on here, and then I said pull up the dubs, and at the very top it says 217, and I'm going, that's a lot of dubs, bro.
But it depends, though, too, because a lot of it's OVA, too, so... So it kind of does kind of add a little bit to it. Some of it's like the OVA stuff, but I mean, that's actually a pretty decent amount of dubs available. I mean, I would say that's close to it, if not all of it.
They really brought their A game. Now, this is one that kills me. Like, I'm a real big Rurouni Kenshin fan, but it was like, hey, this is really good, and then there's a weird dub in here where they pulled in a whole new cast.
Yeah.
And then, hey, we're going to get really good again because we heard you were mad at us for this weird dub. I watched that whole thing as a dub, and it was kind of one of those things where I was like,
"Yeah,
what did you just do right there?"
Weird question.
Yes.
This is actually an open invite, I guess, to any of our podcast family people. I actually have the Rurouni Kenshin live-action movie on Blu-ray and have not watched it yet, and I really want to watch it with the crowd.
Yes! Actually, most live-action stuff, I usually don't watch a lot of live-action.
Right.
When it comes to anime stuff, because it's just... I tend to be, like, especially when it's been dubbed, it's, like, usually it's not very good.
Yeah, live-action dub is cringy.
I did watch Battleship Yamato.
Yeah.
Which was based on Star Blazers. I watched Battleship Yamato live-action film, and it was really good, and for a while, it was available on Funimation.
Yeah. Which is something that I've noticed, that Funimation has put in a few of their movies on there, but not, like, when it comes to their anime series, they have a lot on there, but, like, movie-wise, they've actually done a lot of films, but, like, if it's not part of a series, it's not going to be on there. It's not on Funimation at all. And it's something that I would love to see them, you know, throw on Funimation. I would love to see them throw Your Name once it becomes available.
Mm.
All of these other films that they do have. Because they have a lot of the films from the guy who did The Boy and the Beast.
That's a movie I need to watch. Have you seen the dub of that, or have you seen the film?
Yes, I saw it actually in theaters.
See, I didn't get to see it. That is one I didn't get to see.
Done by... they actually have all of this as Mamoru Hosoda is one that they've actually have on there as well. They have all of his films that he's done.
Okay.
They actually have licensed every single one. So, I love every film that he's done. Like, his best one, by far, I think one of his best ones is Wolf Children. Because it's really good.
Okay. You guys are going to mess around with
it. I think it's his... What?
You guys are going to make me mess around with this. I feel it coming. It's just a wrap. I'm done.
Go home tonight. Watch anime until the sun rises.
Yeah.
And be like, the sun rises and you're still watching anime. 24 hours later, you're still watching anime. I gotta go work in like an hour. I'm still watching it.
Yeah. Everybody say, what did you do last night? The epic, awesome show. And then it just continued to this morning. That's all I get.
So, with that being said, I think we've pretty much covered a lot of stuff here today. So, thank you guys so much for coming on the show.
Yeah, oh, man, thanks for having us, man. This was a total blast.
Oh, yeah.
All right. So, with that being said, guys, if you guys want to check out what they are, what they're up to and everything else, I have links in the description below so you can get it, watch their stuff. You can watch some of their, you know, it's for TeamLift is it Go TeamLift? Or is it TeamLift?
It depends on if you're looking for us on social media. It's Go TeamLift, but find us on like YouTube. It's the TeamLift podcast, and we have our video channel. Yeah.
Okay, so I'll link to all that stuff so you can watch what they're up to. And with that being said, thank you guys so much for watching and are listening, whatever way you want to do it. Because you could technically, it's gonna be on YouTube, so technically you can kind of come watch.
Yeah.
You can watch the bar kind of go forward. I mean that's as much interactivity we have. So, but no. That being said, thank you guys so much for watching. Thank you, TeamLift, for being a part of this podcast for this week. And with that being said, thank you guys so much for watching, and I will see you guys on the flip side.